Thank you. Good afternoon. So I'm going to talk about a new type of cement that we are trying to introduce in India. So this will deal with why the new cement and how do we go about with the technology transfer. The motivation for us, this is a large project with several teams, and at IIT Madras, we have a lot of people. These are some of my colleagues who are working on this. The motivation is basically sustainability. How can we increase the sustainability, or how can we ensure sustainability by having a change or a new type of binder being introduced in the market? And when I talk about sustainability, the motivation is that we should get the durability required, or the maximum durability required. We have to look at resources. So when we talk about resources, it is the raw material required, the energy required to make the cement, and water, which is becoming a very big concern in many places like in India. Thirdly would be the carbon footprint, which we are all concerned with in terms of climate change and so on. Then it is very important to look at social acceptance. And we would be surprised that sometimes even a change of color of the cement worries people, and they get turned off and they say that something is wrong with the cement, that is why the color is changing. And finally, but not the least, is the cost. If I think all of us who work in this sector know that if you make the cement too expensive or concrete too expensive, then nobody will use it. So this is the motivation to see if we can look at all these aspects to ensure the sustainability. I will cover some of these aspects in this presentation. So this cement, for short, is called LC3, limestone calcined clay cement. So we are looking at a cement which has a clinker content of about 50%. The rest is limestone and calcined clay and some gypsum. In this presentation, I'm generally talking about a clinker content of 50%. The clinker content in these type of cements could range from 50 to 65%. If it becomes much less than 50%, then the effectiveness is not that much. And if it goes much higher than 65%, really you don't see a benefit in terms of carbon footprint. The ratio between the calcined clay and limestone is 2:1. The clay need not have a very high kaolinite content. There is really no big advantage of going to kaolinite contents more than 50 to 60%. The limestone can be limestone, which is not necessarily required for cement. So it does not compete with the limestone that is used for cement manufacture. And again, the clay need not be anything special, not clay that is used for China clay production. They have been industrial trials done in Cuba and in India. The cement that I'll be talking about, where we've used, comes from a production of about 200 tons of cement made in a regular plant. There are major projects in other parts of the world, and I'm talking about a project that is led by EPFL. So when we talk about a new cement or a new binder, we have to cover the aspects that concern the engineer. So we first looked at what would be needed on the site and to convince someone who's designing with the concrete. So we look at workability, strength, Young's modulus, shrinkage, and so on. So I'll start with those results. And for comparison, I'm also showing you the results of concrete with fly ash. So the OPC is the ordinary Portland cement. The FA30 is a binder with 30% fly ash. And LC3 is the binder that we are concerned with right now. There are three series of concretes. The M30 is the concrete which has a 30 megapascal design strength, may be used for buildings and so on. The M50 is a 50 megapascal strength in infrastructure projects and so on. And then the C mixes are mixes with the same amount of binder and the same water binder ratio. In the others, obviously, you have to change the binder content and the water cement ratio to get the desired strength. And all the mixes had a slump of about 100 millimeters, which is a reasonable slump to use in the site. So I'll show you the comparisons in different aspects of these different mixes. This is the mix design. You don't have to really get much from the numbers. It is just to show that with slight modification of normal mix designs, we can get a concrete at the site with this new cement, the LC3 cement. The strength evolution is very similar. Here the green lines are the ones with LC3. The black lines are with the ordinary Portland cement, and the red lines are with fly ash. We find that it is comparable to the ordinary Portland cement in terms of the evolution. The evolution of strength is faster than in fly ash concretes. So early strength is a little bit higher than with fly ash concrete. So this could be an edge over fly ash concrete. And when we have the same amount of mix, same amount of binder, the LC3 mix does even slightly better than the other concretes. So in general, we find that you can get the strength with just tweaking the mix design. Not much changes have to be done, and you can have a comparable strength evolution. The Young's modulus is almost the same. There's not much difference in the Young's modulus, especially for the same strength grades. If you take into account the scatter, you can think that all of them are almost very similar. The three binder systems are working very similar. In terms of shrinkage, these are results from drying shrinkage. We found that the shrinkage, this is autogenous shrinkage, is the total shrinkage during drying. We find that the LC3 mix always was giving more shrinkage. So this is something that could be a drawback, and we have to take it into account that in most cases, there is a higher, slightly higher when we increase the strength, the difference is much more. Even in the mixes which has the same binder content and water binder ratio, the LC3 mix is always giving slightly more shrinkage. So this is certainly something that has to be taken into account in the mix design, probably reducing the water cement ratio or some type of modification will have to be made if shrinkage is of concern. And obviously it has to be taken into account in the design as well. So in terms of the normal characteristics that we would require, with slight changes, we can get a concrete that would be comparable to concretes with ordinary Portland cement and fly ash. The next step was to go on to durability, look at what are the aspects that change positively and what could be problems with this type of cement. We looked at transport properties, carbonation resistance, chloride-induced corrosion. I'll concentrate basically on these two, because this is probably the biggest causes of failure, especially in countries like us where we do not have freeze-thaw as a major concern. So chloride-induced corrosion is a major concern for us. So we did a wide range of tests looking at chloride ingress, then moisture ingress, gas ingress with oxygen permeability. We looked at the porosity and the pore structure also. And we looked at resistivity as a measure of the possibility of corrosion occurring. So I'll show you some of the results, and we'll see where the differences are very significant and where LC3 comes out better and where it could come out worse. These are the results with surface resistivity. And it is very clear that the mixes with LC3 do much better than the fly ash and OPC. These different bars are for concrete cured for 28 days, 56 days, and 90 days. This bunch is for the common mixes. This is for the M50 concrete, and this is for the M30. Now, in all these cases, you find that the surface resistivity is very high compared to the other concretes. The porosity is refined, and we have generally very high resistivity, indicating that there could be better protection of the steel in the concrete. And this we find in all trends, and obviously with better curing, the results are even better. Now, if you look at chloride ingress, we did the usual RCPT test, which academically there are a lot of doubts about it. Then we did the migration test, which seems to be more acceptable to many people. But mostly we find the same trend, that this is the ingress width of chlorides in LC3 for the different mixes. Next would come the fly ash concrete, and then more ingress or more chlorides going in for the OPC concrete. So we find that there is a very high resistance to chloride ingress. Less chlorides are going through the cover and therefore protecting the steel better. So this was consistent in all the tests that we did when we are looking at how chlorides go into the concrete. And there is a big difference happening. So this is a consequence of that. We looked at the chloride profile. Again, the red, the green dots are for the LC3. The red is for the fly ash concrete and the black with OPC. And you find that whenever we have a blended binder, it does much better, less chlorides going in consistently for all the mixes. And in most cases, the LC3 does as well as the fly ash or better, and much better than the ordinary Portland cement. From the chloride profiles, we fit the equation coming from Fick's second law to get a diffusion coefficient, the apparent chloride diffusion coefficient, and these would be the numbers. So we find that the blended binders do obviously much better than the OPC, and this is the what we would require if we want to do service life modeling. We require the diffusivity, the diffusion of the chlorides through the cover. We need to know how this decays or how it ages. And then thirdly, we need the chloride threshold of corrosion initiation. So this is some factor that we can use into service life modeling. And what it tells us is basically that the cover is going to protect the concrete better when you have LC3 in your system. The chlorides are going to move less easily into the system. One of the reasons, or the principal reason, is the pore structure. The pore structure is refined. Here we have ordinary Portland cement, fly ash cement, and LC3. And if you can compare visually these three, you find that there is a shift towards the left in the LC3 curves. At different ages, you see that the shift is there. And you also see that the refinement occurs in the LC3 systems quite early. In here, you have this spread, which is the effect of age. But here, you find that very early on, the LC3 system becomes refined in porosity, and the porosity is good enough to prevent the chlorides from going in. So we believe that this is what is increasing the resistivity and preventing chlorides from going in, and therefore protecting the steel better. The next thing we did was look at the chloride threshold, because for service life, as I said, we need the diffusivity, we need the aging of the diffusivity, and thirdly, we need the chloride threshold. And we also did impressed corrosion tests to see when and what conditions the cover will crack. So for the chloride threshold, we use this, what we call the lollipop specimen, where we have a steel bar embedded in mortar, and we let it stay in solution with 3.5% sodium chloride. And at different ages or different points in time, we measure what would be the resistivity. So this curve gives the inverse of resistivity, or the conductivity, over time. And what we are looking at is seeing when the curve changes from a certain stable value and it jumps up. So when it jumps up, and to decide how it jumps up, we look at the standard deviation, and we said more than three times the standard deviation, we take it as the corrosion is initiating. So this gives us at what point corrosion is initiated. We break open the specimen and measure what is the chloride content at the interface. And from that, we get the chloride threshold. So we do this for multiple specimens and for different binders. And what we got is this. The results were not what we expected. And what we see is that less clinker, more of blending, decreases the chloride threshold. For the ordinary OPC system, we get this value, which is used a lot in literature, of this 0.4%. But we find out that with 30% fly ash, it goes down to say about 0.3. And with the LC3 system, it goes down to 0.2. After many tests, we have realized that this is consistently occurring, that as you decrease the clinker, the chloride threshold is decreasing, which means that if the chloride reaches the steel for a lower chloride content, the corrosion can initiate. So this is also needed for life cycle assessment, and this becomes then an input. The next thing we did is to look at what will happen to the cover of concrete. Suppose the concrete is made with LC3 versus fly ash plus cement and just ordinary Portland cement. This is a test which is quite popular, which is embedding a steel piece and then you impress current or impress voltage in this case and see when the concrete cracks. The cracking obviously occurs because the rust formation increases volume, induces a tension in the system, and therefore the cover cracks. So this is to simulate that. And what we found is in the 500 hours of testing, the ordinary Portland system failed first, that is the end of these curves, and then the fly ash, but the LC3 system almost never cracked. Even at 500 hours, it doesn't crack at all. And we are looking into it and seeing why it doesn't happen, and it looks like the product that is formed at the interface when corrosion occurs is not that expansive. These are the preliminary results we are having, but we are looking more into it. But what we have found very clearly is under similar conditions, under the same impressed voltage, the corrosion is not causing the cracking of the cover when we use LC3 versus the others. In terms of carbonation, we've done tests under accelerated carbonation, 1% and 3%, and using the phenolphthalein test, we look at the depth of carbonation that occurs. And here, the news is also not great. We find that, again, when we decrease the clinker, the binder or the concrete carbonates more. The green lines are LC3. This is the carbonation depth. The LC3 system carbonates much more. The carbonation depth is much more than in the other systems. We find that very consistent. This is the common mixes or the same binder and water binder ratio, and we find that always we have the LC3 system carbonating more. And again, this is consistent with what we have in the literature and what recent studies. When you decrease the clinker content, we are going to have more carbonation. And this obviously is something that we'll have to take into account either by decreasing the water cement ratio or to have something that prevents carbonation from occurring. We've also done sulfate resistance tests. I don't think I have the results, but generally there was not a major difference. So having done this, we wanted to see now how can we make industry or how can we encourage the industry to produce this cement. As I told you, we've done a couple of trials, one of about 200 tons of cement that was produced. What we did is produced a resource map of our country. So what we find here is dots of different colors. The green and the purple dots are the cement plants. The green plants are the integrated plants, which both produce the clinker, grind, and make cement. The purple ones are just grinding units, which would take clinker from somewhere and then grind. The red dots are thermal power plants, which would be the source of fly ash. The yellow dots are where we have clay. So we were looking to see if there were places where you need cement, but you don't have fly ash, then LC3 could be an alternative. So we identified different regions, which are marked here, where we could potentially have the necessity for an alternative to blended cement with fly ash. So this is now being discussed with industry to see if they could set up plants there, and obviously we have to look at the cost. The final aspect that I'd like to discuss is what is related to the carbon dioxide emission or the carbon footprint. So what we did is we chose in one of those yellow areas, in this case in the south, in a place called Arialur, which is a very rich limestone belt. And we went there and we got data related to the raw materials going in and the emissions from the cement plant to do a life cycle assessment. For a place like India and many emerging countries, we don't have a database like you would have in Europe. So we have to build the database, we have to get the inventory from primary data or data collected from the site. And what we find is this. Again, I have to mention that this system is what can be called as the cradle-to-gate or ground-to-gate or mine-to-gate, where we take everything into account from the extraction of the material until the cement leaves the cement plant. So we take all that into account and we calculate what are the emissions in terms of CO2 and the energy required. So this is ordinary Portland cement. It is about the 800 kg per ton of cement that mostly would coincide with literature. This decreases to about 600 kg when we have, say, 25 to 30% of fly ash in the cement. And when we have an LC3 system, we have assumed a calcination energy which is on the high side for clay, just to be conservative in our numbers, and we decrease to about 560, again, much less than the OPC and maybe even less than the PPC. So this is the primary motivation for a new cement in the market, if we can decrease the carbon emissions significantly. And why is it important? We've heard a lot that 5 to 8% of CO2 emissions in the world comes from the cement industry. And there are countries like many emerging countries like in Asia, like India and Africa, which are going to produce more and more cement. Our cement production right now in India is about 350 million tons. And you can imagine the numbers, because this morning, Sergio was telling about 2 million tons in Spain. So we are at about 350 million tons. China is obviously much higher. We are second in the world, and we seem to go towards more of 500 million tons to 1,000 million tons in the next years. So that means if we continue to do just with OPC, we are going to emit more and more CO2, and it is very important to be able to change the technology and bring in something that takes care of all the other aspects like consumer acceptance and costs, but also gives less carbon emissions. The energy requirement is also less, so this means that less fuel is burnt and less cost. Obviously, it cannot beat fly ash, because fly ash is a totally waste product. So that is the reason why we are looking at places where fly ash is not available, thermal plants are not available. Where does this big change come from? Because of the clinker. So even though there are many, many processes involved in the life cycle impact, the main impact is always from the clinker. The other aspects are so negligible that we could even neglect them. Even when there is some calcination energy, calcination occurring, and you are burning some fuel, still, when you decrease the clinker content, you have a very significant decrease because of the clinker decrease. The same trends we see also in concrete. So I'll show you quickly some results on concrete, where these are for the M30 concretes, all of them having a characteristic design strength of 30 megapascal, and we see that if we compare with an ordinary Portland cement concrete, concrete with 30% fly ash, this is almost similar, again much less. So each time we use this, we are going to save a lot of cement in the, a lot of CO2 in the order of about 10%. When the grade increases, the quality becomes better. When we go to a higher grade, then you have a better comparison, and this, the improvement is much more. So higher grade of concrete will benefit certainly more, even in terms of the carbon emissions per ton or per cubic meter of concrete. So this is basically what I have. It's a work in progress, and we are looking at how to make sure that the industry can be interested. We're looking at different aspects that the industry is keen on so that we can do an effective technology transfer, and we are trying to get more cement companies involved so that there can be more people who will be interested in making the cement. Right now, as I said, there have been large trials in Cuba and in India, and right now we have teams in Thailand and China also looking at it. And obviously for this work, we need a lot of people. So here we have a lot of graduate students, or slaves, as Doug calls them. We call them graduate students. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'll be glad to take questions if there are any. Yes, Slava. Frost resistance, we did not study. We did not study because in Chennai we don't get much frost, except. But there are, certainly. We have not studied. We have not studied, I don't know. Creep, okay. We are studying creep. Basically, if we look at literature of creep on different binders, we see that it's related a lot to the paste content. So it will depend a lot on how much you modify the concrete mix in terms of the paste content. When the paste content and the water binder ratio is similar, we seem to have very similar creep behavior. But if there is a big difference, certainly, and this happens also in other systems where you put in a lot of cement paste, then it would creep more. Yes, Nicola. Yes. But this is calcined clay.
Yeah, but it's never fully calcined. So, we had this discussion already some 2 years ago. Since then, have you noticed any problems with admixtures?
Yes and no. We are looking at intending to have the kaolinite calcine. So, we have studied well what is the temperature range to have the transition to the amorphous phase. We know that it is, say, about 700 to 800 degrees. So we are controlling, and obviously we have to do the process well enough such that everything is calcined. We have an issue with superplasticizer because the 200 tons were done by intergrinding, and the clay is easier to make finer. So what happens is we ended up with a cement where the clay was ending up much finer than the clinker. So the surface area was very high, and therefore the superplasticizer dosage did increase. So now what we are doing is the next trial, we are trying to do an interblending, where we would first grind the clinker and then have the mixing like it's often done for fly ash. So that is an issue. In our case, we did find that we had to increase the dosage of superplasticizer, but you could get the same level of workability, but with a higher superplasticizer dosage. No, the idea is to grind the clay separately and then blend it. Yeah, we will have to grind separately and blend it, because the grinding of both, since you have two materials with very high difference in hardness, the clinker was not ending up fine enough, but the clay was ending up very high, and we had a blain of 600 instead of, say, 400. So certainly, these are some things that are technological issues that we did not anticipate. So until you make these 200 tons, you don't realize that these things occur. So certainly this is of concern, because it will also affect the energy and so on. Yeah, Mark?
One of the problems that you'll face is resistance from your specifying authority.
Sure.
Can't you put this into the low grade? If you look at how much cement is used, particularly in countries like India and my own country, just in site-based construction, mortars, renders, and so on.
Right.
In fact, all cement is used in that anymore.
That's right.
Is this not the market that you're
doing? We are looking at it. So what we've come up with, the concept, previously I talked about LC3. Now we've come up with the concept of LC2, which is just limestone calcined clay. So the idea is to have somebody make limestone calcined clay and mix it with the cement, say in the concrete plant, and there it would not have to become a standardized cement. But obviously there are other issues that you're talking about. Can we look at ready mix mortars and so on? Right now people are talking about it, but we still don't have a large production in the industry yet. But certainly we'll have to look at it, because making it a standardized cement is going to take a lot of time. But what the industry says, it might be easier to have it in the concrete system rather than as sold as a cement. Frankly, no. No. It's not the porosity, because the porosity is refined. So it's not just the porosity. I don't know if it is just that the capillary stresses are higher, because as we understand that the shrinkage is when drying occurs, there is capillary stresses which are pulling on the pores, and therefore the shrinkage could be higher. I don't know. We have not looked at it. We are continuing to study it, but we don't have a clear explanation right now on what is happening.
Question regarding the footprint. Pictures you showed the LC cements were quite
Right. So we've done some work. I didn't present it right here, where we've looked at service life, considering that service life is until the initiation of corrosion, and the system with LC3 comes out better, because as I said, there are three factors which are governing the service life: the diffusivity, the decay of the diffusivity, and the chloride threshold. So the first two are so much higher that they compensate for the chloride threshold. So if you have life dominated by chloride-induced corrosion, we don't have anything to worry about. But if you have a system where there is not going to be any chloride-induced corrosion, but you're going to have severe carbonation, then you would be in trouble whenever you have lower clinker content. Yes. So we will have to look at what is the cause of the end of life, and therefore we will have to look at it. So what we are trying to see is model service life with the parameters that we've gotten. So we look at service life rather than just this. And what we are trying to do is combine the concept of service life with the carbon footprint and see if both together could be the way to decide whether to use one binder or not. Any other questions? Yes, Doug. I wouldn't know by memory. Yeah. Yes. Then we'll have a higher volume. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I could check that. I have a feeling that all the mixed designs that I showed you were adjusted for 2,400 kg per meter cube. But I'll have to go and check if really the yield was higher than a meter cube because of the higher volume of the paste. I'll have to check that. I have a feeling that was taken into account, but I'm not really sure. I'll have to check that.
The other question, all your strength data was started on 2-day strength.
Yes.
Did you measure any 1-day strength? Which is really a construction issue.
I know. No, I think we measure 2-day strength, and I think now we are measuring 1-day strength, 1, 3, and so on. But initially, we started off with 2-day strength, which was easier to manage in the lab with the people that we had. They were more used to doing 2-day strength. And with 1-day strength, you have to be more careful because plus minus 2-3 hours can make a big difference. So we did not. We looked more at 2-day strength, but we will have to look at more strength data. That's point well made. Okay, thank you.